Welcome to another edition of The Vote. Today we've got with us the Reverend Anthea Ballam, who I've known for what seems like most of my life, sadly. And we're going to talk a little bit about religion, religious tensions within the city, and also about a very exciting project that her organisation that she's involved with, the Interfaith
Contact Group.
Contact Group. Mm-hmm. It has got on the go. So, Anthea, welcome to the studio and to the latest. Tell us a little bit about the work of the Interfaith Contact Group and how long has it been going, for instance?
Well, it's been going for well over 20 years. The idea really was to get lots of different faiths talking to each other in a kind of nice way. It's really what the name says. It's a contact group, but it's developed since then. Over the last 20 years, it's gained a lot of sort of impetus in the sense that we now create events and opportunities, everything from conferences and sitting around things to services. There's an interfaith service in November where people of all faiths get together and enjoy each other's company and talk to each other, in some cases eat with each other and share experiences so that the differences in faith. And it deals with all faiths and none. So we have quite a lot of people who don't believe in anything, but they do believe in what we do, which is a great compliment. And it's a very, very active and caring group which represents all these different faiths in Brighton and Hove. And it's proactive and it's fun. It's fun. It's
real fun. OK, well, I have to confess I've been to one or two of your events, so I can confess they are fun. Except for when you asked me to do lots of onerous duties. One of the events I went to was at one of our major hotels on the seafront,
yes,
which seemed to be packed to the gunwales, and this was an event to celebrate
Ramadan.
Yes. And we had addresses from bishops and priests and all sorts of people. And it seemed to me that the spirit that seemed that was abound was a very positive spirit, but we do have some negative spirits around in the city because there are rising incidents of anti-Semitism, Islamophobia. How does your group deal with that, and what are you trying to do to counter those negative forces?
Well, first of all, that event which you mentioned wasn't strictly one of ours. We worked very closely with the Dialogue Society,
yeah,
which is a group which is run by, in fact, the Islamic community, one of the Islamic communities in Brighton Hove. But that's a perfect example of how closely we work with all the different groups and religious, you know, people within Brighton Hove. Sorry, I've forgotten the question now.
Well, how do you, as the Interfaith Contact Group, mm-hmm, manage and deal and go out and try and oppose Islamophobia, anti-Semitism,
right,
anti-Christians? Because, you know, a lot of people,
definitely,
are still anti-Christian and they will see some Christians as fundamentalists and they are quite vocal in expressing views against them.
I think that, personally, one of the best ways to actually get people to talk to each other is not really to proselytise. You can't say to somebody, you're right or you're wrong. That absolutely doesn't work. So if you get people on an even footing so that they're sitting across a table or eating together, it creates an understanding between people, the ability for people to see that they're the same. Now, you're absolutely right. There are incidents of anti-Semitism which cause great grief and other intolerances. But if you can create scenarios which are open and public where people meet and talk to each other, you begin to break down barriers. And also if you get into places like school where people are young and talk to young people. I mean, I go to a wonderful school, absolutely fantastic, where they have a marvellous programme of getting all the young people to do interfaith projects where they learn about different faiths and they take on the identity of different faiths. Absolutely wonderful. Am I allowed to say which school it is?
You can.
It's
a
Downs Junior School. They have a wonderful interfaith programme of getting young people to identify with different faith groups and write them up, study their history and be involved with them, find out what they eat. Those kind of things are so brilliant for breaking down barriers and getting people to understand each other, the students talk to each other, young people. So it's really a matter of creating really beautiful platforms which people enjoy and share things and talk to each other. And in that way, yes, we are able to get people to understand and appreciate and realise that, in fact, they're really the same.
But do you think some of the religions that, in their practices, go out deliberately to divide and separate? I mean, what's your view about faith schools, which are kind of uni-faithed, and are they just prolonging difference, or what's your view?
I mean, I think that faith schools of a certain faith could fall into that position, but I think that the people who teach within them are really the key to this thing, and their openness is the key to the thing. And I think that where you get a city, I mean, we are so gifted with this extraordinary city with this amazing vision and amazing ability for people of all kinds to talk to each other. In fact, I was talking about this in the taxi on the way here, that we are really so gifted with a city that is so open-minded and so loving, that is really the beginning of where people start talking to each other. So it doesn't matter if the label on the package or on the school is, you know, it's Christian or Islamic or whatever. If people within that teaching environment allow people to understand that there's a great similarity between different faiths and none, you know, we can agree with things, we can understand each other, we can appreciate each other in a way.
But what, I mean, it's one thing to talk about the teachers, but children go home at the end of the day, and they go home to their parents, who may well have very fixed views. So does it stop at the school gate, this kind of attitude which could change people's minds? I mean, I just think about what's going on or has gone on in Northern Ireland for years, where Protestants would be one side of the track and Catholics would be on the other, and that's how their lives progress, even to the extent of having walls between communities to keep them from cutting each other's throats all the time. So is that what's happening with faith schools even in Brighton and Hove?
I don't have enough knowledge of what goes on in faith schools, but I do know that these opportunities for people to meet and match and kind of do things is very much in the air. It's almost an atmosphere. I mean, this project that hopefully we'll talk about is an example. There are places and spaces where people of difference can get together and talk, and that is really the opportunity. I mean, in a way, almost any social situation allows for that. You know, even a cafe, whatever. When people get together in groups and find that there are similarities rather more than differences, they then begin to understand that their prejudices are misplaced. So it's really experience and sharing.
Well, we should actually tell viewers that you are an interfaith minister. Mm-hmm. So you kind of are across most of the traditions, but not actually proselytising for any particular religion.
No. I mean, I am an interfaith minister, and it's a wonderful thing because it means for things like funerals, I really work hard to make sure that everybody in a space, whether it's 10 people or it's 500, that they all feel as though they're part of that service. Because in a very small number, you're going to get somebody who's an atheist, somebody who's a devout Christian, somebody who's a Jew, and so on. I mean, in the society we have, there's always a great variety of people with different points of view. So what you have to do is you have to make them all feel that they belong and what they're doing is right there, and they can connect with the person who's died in the case of a funeral. So it's a matter of just making people feel comfortable and making them feel that this is where they can share something and connect with somebody. So funerals are a really good example of how you can get people of diversity together feeling, in fact, as though they can connect, even though their belief is different. And they have every right to their belief, however different it may be.
I mean, we talked, I just mentioned what has been going on in Northern Ireland for generations. And of course, we have what's going on in the Middle East as another example of people of what looks like on the outside the same faith warring with each other. So we have Shias and the other branches of Muslims killing each other in the name of Allah. I mean, how does an interfaith society such as your own, the one you belong to, how does that overcome those kinds of prejudices that allow people to go out and kill each other?
It's so much to do with creating spaces and places where people can share ideas. Once people, I mean, one of the things, for example, is our service. We have an annual service. We started about 7 years ago, which takes place either on or just outside Interfaith Week. And the year before last, we had it in the synagogue, and the synagogue was full of people from Muslim backgrounds. And
We're going to have to come back to that after this break, so we'll talk about that and your initiative as well.
Thank you.
Well, welcome back. With me is the Reverend Anthea Ballam, who is an interfaith minister and also secretary of the Interfaith
Contact Group.
So before the break, we were talking about the internecine strife between faiths, Roman Catholics and Protestants in Ireland, various branches of Islam. And some of these strifes are kind of fermented by governments who seem to arm one side against the other. There seems to be no solutions to some of these things, but there is some hope. So organisations like yours are striving quietly in the background to do something about it. And we were talking about some of the events you have organised in the past, where you just bring people together and they realise they are just ordinary human beings like themselves.
Absolutely.
But, I mean, is this going to be enough to overcome? Because we seem to be a lot of fundamentalism and various other things that go on in the firmament, in the background, seem to act as a trigger to stoke anti-Semitism, Islamophobia. So is there a sort of a political dimension that needs to be tackled before people can just come to treat people with respect and acceptance? I mean, we've got governments who feel they want to march about the world stage, and in doing so, they seem to give a trigger to people who have hate in their hearts to express the most vile sort of sentiments.
Absolutely true. And I think that governments are very much at fault in making faith groups antagonistic towards each other. I think that that's the real problem. I think a lot of it is about politics. It's very interesting. Lots of people say, oh, all the world's trouble are to do with religion. Actually, they're not. Religious groups do an enormous amount of good social work and really, really help people. And, you know, in this town, lots and lots of people who are homeless are fed by Christian groups and also the Muslim community and Jewish groups all do. Faith groups do so much socially, but the differences are stoked up really by politicians much more than I think people within the faith groups. People within the faith groups are really much more open and ready to talk to each other than we realise.
But, I mean, our politicians in this country, well, certainly in this city, seem to be much more sensitive to these issues, but it's the politicians that seem to be operating elsewhere and on world stages that seem to be the problem. I mean,
yes.
I mean, we have a White House at the moment, which is run by a gentleman who feels that he wants to build walls
Absolutely.
Rather than put the hand of friendship out to people. But that kind of gets then translated into other actions in other places all over the world.
Well, just imagine, if you want to take over the world, Geoffrey, what better way to do it?
I had that thought last night.
I think you should do it. What better way to do it than actually to say, this group is just the voice of evil and the spawn of the devil, and you must attack them. And that is what actually unites and controls people. And we all know Hitler did that, and all sorts of leaders, Stalin. You actually create a group that is considered to be a bad thing, either a religious group or a faith group or a political group, and you identify that group. You make your friends and your supporters believe that that group is bad, and then you actually use that prejudice as a way of controlling and manipulating power.
But do you think some of the hate that that displays itself with graffiti, broken windows, desecrated tombstones, comes about as a result of ill-chosen words from politicians, or is it always there, latent and ready to come out when people feel under threat? I mean, one of the issues that is very current is, you know, that we're endlessly talking about Brexit. And I feel every time anyone mentions Brexit, we should put a coin into a box, because it's going on, and it seems to be going on pervasively. But what drove some of the Brexiteers, it appears, is fear of the other, immigration. So immigrants look different, they have different religions, and they become targets. Is this something that the Interfaith Contact Group is considering? I mean, this whole immigration debate and how it actually foments hatred to other religions.
It's something that I think about a lot, but I think the Interfaith Contact Group is much more about getting people together and getting them to discuss things amongst themselves and creating opportunities and events and spaces and places where people can discuss these things. But the fact of the matter is that we all have our own views, and I think that on the whole it's politicians that are using people and using religion in order to just stoke up hatred.
Well, before we all sort of want to sort of stab our eyeballs out with a blunt fork and cut our throats, tell us about, you've got a rather interesting initiative which is going to hopefully sweep the city with enthusiasm. Tell us about Angel Day.
Well, Angel Day is a whole thing. It's going to take 9 months for
everybody. Here's something I prepared earlier.
Oh, yes.
So this is, if we can go, probably can't go close on that. That's a leaflet with a rather lovely looking illustration on the front and another one on the back. Probably I had to hold this up in a way that can be seen. But tell us a little bit about that. And
well, this is the launch of Angel Day, which is on Saturday the 10th of February.
Okay, coming up very soon.
Very soon. And there's going to be a wonderful day with printmaking workshops and drawing workshops and music workshops, all sorts of fabulous things. I'm just reading my list of all the exciting things that are going on.
I shall take that away from you and screw it up so you don't have... so you can be more instantaneous. Go on,
sorry.
Yes.
Well, I can never remember. It's very early in the day. But, yes, it's going to be a wonderful initiative. It came from one of our Islamic community who was explaining to me, or I think explained to our group, that within the Islamic tradition, there's an awful lot of interest in angels. In fact, it's one of the key things of Islam, is that you are... You believe in angels and they're part of your life. And angels are as much built into the Islamic ethos as it is in the Christian one and also the Jewish one and also Baha'i and within other faiths. There are very angel-like beings.
I didn't know. Looking at your leaflet, I didn't know, for instance, and there's a lovely little illustration here of an angel hovering over an Egyptian mummy.
Yes, sarcophagus, yes. So it's great, isn't it?
Angels seem to go back even further.
Just a couple of 3,000, 4,000 years, something like that.
Okay.
So the Sumerians as well.
Okay, so the theme is angels, and I believe there's going to be something going on in Brighton Museum.
The museum is going on, you know, the thing of the day, which is on the 10th of February, which is a Saturday. And as I say, we'll have lots of lovely things going on. After that, there's going to be a competition. And the competition is to find the angel of Brighton Hove. And they can do that by writing something, 250 words, or they can actually do a beautiful painting or drawing or a piece of sculpture and send us an image to our website. And then we will choose, we will exhibit some of the people who are actually putting ideas in. And we are going to find, right across all age groups, the angel of Brighton Hove, either in words or image.
Okay, so we could end up with a sort of an angel of the north standing out in the sea with its arms stretched out.
Could do. I mean, we've got one, haven't we, with the peace statue. That does a good job.
This one here.
Yeah, I love the peace statue.
You can
it's
hold
a great
that up
thing.
Because you're on camera.
Okay, I'm on camera. Hello, and here's the peace statue.
Okay, right.
And I love the peace statue. I think it's a great thing. I think it stands very strategically between Brighton and Hove, stopping us from actually attacking each other in a vicious and unpleasant way.
Yes.
Well, the Hovish people and the Brightonish people.
Absolutely.
It's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful thing.
And don't forget Port St. Lada as well.
Oh, yes, as well. I forgot about them. We mustn't never forget them.
Okay, so the idea is that there's going to be a workshop going on in the museum on the 10th.
Yes. Many workshops.
Many workshops
and music.
Yeah.
All sorts of things going on.
And you've got a couple of very interesting artists involved already. Tell us something about them.
Oh, they are really amazing. We've got two artists, and they are actually part of this thing, and also a beautiful little booklet that we'll be giving out on the day, which is really lovely. The main artists, of course, is Cosmo Sarson, who made this fantastic, beautiful mural, which you can see in Regent Street in North Lane.
Yeah.
It's a work of art. It's just magnificent. And he's going to talk about his work as a graphic, you know, what a graffiti artist, but his work is far too good for graffiti. Absolutely beautiful. So he's been very generous. He's coming over to talk to us.
He's a sort of a local Banksy, is he?
No, he's not local. He comes from Bristol. He's coming all the way to see us to talk about it.
B. It begins with a B. It's almost
a B. And the other one is Anne Darcy Hughes, whose work is also...
Oh, she's a printmaker, isn't she?
She's a printmaker, and she just does angels. That's all she does. And she's one of the jewels in Brighton's crown, in the sense that she's very, very gifted.
I think she works out of a studio just around the corner from me in Kemp Town.
That's right. She's going to do a workshop, I think, at 10, I'm hoping. And she's going to show people how to do printmaking. And then we'll have other workshops. We're going to have a music workshop as well.
Okay, well, we're very near the end. So I'm going to give the website where people can find out more about this Angel initiative. It's www.interfaithcontactgroup.com. Anthea Ballam, thank you very much for coming in to talk to us. Tune in again later this week for another edition of The Vote.